bypassing your cognition, your survival system was tactical, it had your back. And suddenly this should empower everybody and go, holy fuck, I never realized if I did this one drill and he went boom and hit me while I was talking, it'd be like Chiclet City with a Pez dispenser. It could be your dog, it could be, I don't give a shit what it is, something that's gonna make you get ferocious and find that indignation. What this then becomes is this. So how do we defeat this action versus reaction model? Because the bad guy will always be action. Everyone tracking that? The bad guy's always gonna have the jump on you because he's waiting now. So that's what we call the jack-in-the-box moment. The way you beat action is through inaction. Inaction is the art and science of going, I see that. It's having tactical awareness, not just the scenario, but on the pre-contact cues. When, let me borrow you again, when I practice this for 10,000 reps, and I'm an outlier as far as getting out of a headlock, and I go, okay, class, in the headlock, secure the hand, hook the face, hit the groin, grab, you know, and you practice that over and over, and you go, let's do it again. You get really, really good, okay? And to me, it's like clearing a jam in a gun. How many of you shoot? Anybody shoot here? A bunch of you, good. Okay, it's like clearing a jam. You get really, really good at it. You recognize the conflict, I clear it. How many of you want to get in a gunfight and hope for a jam because you're good at clearing? Fuck, and I hope I get a gunfight and my gun jams because I'm really good at clearing. How about getting really good at going, that guy's gonna shoot me in a second, I'm gonna shoot him first. That'd be an even better skill. Okay, so to me the headlock is a malfunction because everything that you didn't know failed you and put you in that compromised position. So how do we do that? We start looking at scenarios. We start looking at things in terms of stimulus response, what happens before I practice this complex motor skill. And that puts me in action, and inaction beats action. When you spell inaction, always use the hyphen, because inaction without the hyphen means I did nothing. And people who have no pre-contact cue awareness, who don't know how to move their emotional, psychological self, are in action. They're immobilized by fear, what I call emotional inertia, which is your body's inability to move because your mind won't move. You're just fucking frozen. If you got a bad feeling about something, immediately address it as quick as you can. You think you're being followed, stop, turn around, and look. And if there's somebody there who does this, that's a bad sign, right? But do I want to know that at 20 feet or 2 feet? So if I walk with the little blinders on going, oh, I hope they're not following me, oh, you know, you're probably leading them to your house or to your car or to some other place instead of stopping right there. And like Albert DeSalvo, most bad guys don't want to get caught or don't get hurt. So if you're going to shine the spotlight on them early, there's a statistical chance that they're just going to bolt if it's opportunistic. Someone always asks, and since you guys have used up your quota of questions, I'll ask it for you. I always have somebody ask about, what if you turn around and you say, are you following me? And they are, and they come towards you. And I say the same thing I just told you. But now you know at 20 feet. You've got 20 feet to emotionally and psychologically get your shit together, whether it's Nike dough or innovate dough, right? Right? So is that the right position? That was better. Fuck, I was heel striking in my demo. Fuck. So we had a woman taking my course, and she didn't show up for class. So I call her up, I go, hey. And do you guys understand when I tell these stories that's the lesson? If I went equals MC squared, you're like, what? But you remember the story and find yourself in the story. So I call her up, I go, hey, how you doing? Because she was like a very aggressive in the classes, coming all the time. And then she disappears. And she says, yeah, hey, coach, sorry. Yeah, I'll be back soon. I just got to take a couple weeks off. But I could tell like something happened. And I was concerned that it happened during a seminar, that it happened at the class. And like a conscientious coach, you want to know, did you hurt yourself here? You know? And so I said, look, if you don't want to talk about it, that's cool. But if you do want to talk about it, let me know. It was something to do with the self-defense and the training. She goes, well, my ribs are hurt, and they did probably a couple of weeks. And I said, your ribs are hurt? Did someone do that to you here? She goes, no, in the street. I'm like, what? She goes, yeah. She says, okay. And she starts to tell me, on the McGill campus. I used to live in Montreal. She's crossing the campus, and she gets the sense that somebody's following her, and she remembers from the seminar, immediately addresses it. So she stops, and she goes, "Are you following me?" And he pauses and looks around and then doesn't say a word and slowly starts to walk towards her. And she goes, "Oh my God, I was like going, he's gonna run, but he didn't, he kept towards me," and I freaked. My hands came up and I was like, I knew I was in for it and I didn't want to get raped again. And she said, "Again," and I'd never known, right? And I'm like, "Oh shit." And she says, he walks right up to me and I'm like not breathing, I'm not thinking, and he grabs my elbow and he says, "If you cooperate with me, I won't hurt you." Okay? And she leads him off, he leads her off like into this little wooded area near these buildings. And then she says, "I remember you saying when you cooperate with a rapist, you're gonna get raped." And I said, and I kept saying to myself, get in your stance. And I realized, and the next thing we're gonna do after lunch or a break is this whole block on nonviolent postures, which is this, because this betrays the element of surprise, and this is also a complex motor skill. That if I whip something at you right now, if I took my coffee out and I sprayed it, everybody here would look like the baseball picture. Whoa, what the fuck? Your survival system doesn't go cold coffee or baseball bat, it just goes, what the fuck? Stimulus gets introduced too quickly, hands come up to protect the command center of your head. So she's walking, and one of the fighting stances that we teach people is this. Oh shit. Like if this is where your hands are, that's where you need to fight from. Imagine if this is your fighting stance and your hands are here. What is your emotional psychological system doing? It's going, this isn't gonna work. That's not what I was trained to do. My instructor must not know what real fights are like because everything's far away. She ends up, she's walking, she pauses and he's leading her along. He thinks that she's the helpless, complacent victim, right? If I was leading you along and you stopped walking, what would I do? Would I immediately attack you or would I pause and go back? Behaviorally, I would just stop, right? What are you doing? She starts clawing at his eyes, screaming, slamming forearms and hands at him. And he goes like this. So he's walking with her. Let me borrow you, Pete. So come on this side here. You're covering your head, okay? And we're walking slowly towards Mel. And whenever you want, just pause. So we're gonna walk a little bit. Do you see how behaviorally sound that was, what I did there? I didn't, the helpless victim. So that's all we did is we're walking, we stop, I turn like this. Look where the weapons are. Remember I told you when you flinch, the weapons are locked and loaded. Thanks, let's give Pete a big golf clap. Little loud for golf, work on that. So listen, she just, at that point there, she just pulls the trigger and she fucking goes berserk on this guy. What does he do? Does he start going? What does he do? Start a flinch, his hands come up. He's been nailed. But now this is a total predator-prey reversal. Because the last time he raped somebody, they cooperated, like Albert DeSalvo's victims, right? He does this to her. Boom, he kicks her and runs. She says, "I'm screaming and I'm clawing at this guy and he kicked me and ran." I said, "Excuse me, are you telling me that the attempted rapist kicked you in self-defense?" I swear to God I said that to her, and she started to laugh, and that was the break of her PTSD cycle, post-traumatic stress disorder, because nobody said good fucking job. Almost is the same as did in self-defense. I almost was attacked, but I stopped and turned around and said, "Don't come any closer." I've had guys walk up to my car and my windows are down. I go, "Hey, stop there." I go, "Just got a court." No, stop there. Stop there, I'm getting out of the fucking car. Whoa, easy, man. I can hear you and you can hear me, so you don't need to move any closer. I don't do that with everybody, right? But, but you need to understand what it was, you laughed and I'm being serious, because you need to understand that I don't want you as a default mechanism, if somebody walks up to you to fucking go ballistic, you know, pull out that, a fucking flamethrower, you know, and, right, in terms of a verbal counter. But what we talk about, and everything fits together, so D1, D2, D3, the three Ds is detect, defuse, USE to take the fuse out, and then defend. And so real self-defense is really 66% of it is about having your awareness and your shit together here.